welcome. Thanks for attending the GU Oncology Conference Highlights focused on ASCO GU 2022. We are going to switch to bladder cancer, and I am going to quickly share Dr. Sampavde's disclosures, and then Guru will let you share screen to share your slides.
Thanks, Jake. Can you all see the slide set?
Yes, we can.
Okay, good. So this is the bladder cancer update, and I'm going to zip through a lot of slides really quickly, and I might zip past some of the background slides for the trials, since you most of you know all the background for these studies. So as you all know, urothelial carcinoma treatment has been transformed by a number of new agents. We routinely use the Javelin paradigm, platinum-based chemo, followed by maintenance avelumab. And then we have a couple of antibody drug conjugates, enfortumab and sacituzumab. And then we have a targeted agent, erdafitinib, for FGFR 2 or 3 activated patients with the activating mutations or fusions. And in the perioperative setting, of course, we have the arrival of adjuvant nivolumab in patients with high-risk muscle-invasive disease, post-cystectomy or nephroureterectomy. So getting to the major studies, I will just summarize overall to say that there is not something that immediately changes practice, but there was interesting data that informs us regarding further development of drugs. So this is the phase 3 trial that was at GU ASCO, and this is a combination of lenvatinib with pembrolizumab compared with pembrolizumab alone as first-line therapy. So this is a first-line trial in patients who were either cisplatin ineligible, PD-L1 high, or were platinum ineligible in the first-line setting, comparing len-pembro versus placebo-pembro. And the background is just briefly that VEGF and PD-1 combinations have looked interesting in various phase 1-2 trials that led to this phase 3 trial. Now, the bottom line is that the data safety monitoring committees closed the trial before full accrual. The full accrual, 694 patients, but they stopped around 2/3 of the way. So why did this happen? Just looking at this study, you see that this is a bad patient population, first line platinum ineligible patients, most of them, a lot of them had PS2, 80% PS2 patients. Liver mets 25% did not stick out too much for me, but it is a bad patient population with the 80% PS2. I've never seen such a high PS2 patient population in any trial. So the PFS is similar, around 4 to 4.5 months. Median survival similar, around 1 year for both the pembro and len-pembro arms. Response rate also similar, which I was very surprised. You would expect to see some improvement in response rate. Adding a VEGF inhibitor, response rate similar, around 30% for both the arms. Toxicities, of course, were more with len-pembro, as you might expect, combining a VEGF TKI with pembrolizumab compared to pembro alone. So this is essentially a disappointing study, phase 3 study of a novel combination in the first-line setting, but the study may have been compromised by a very high percentage of PS2 patients, which was 80% of all patients. I will add here that there, of course, is a switch maintenance trial going on, looking at a different VEGF inhibitor, cabozantinib, combined with avelumab in the switch maintenance setting that just activated through the cooperative groups. The second study I wanted to highlight is a what the urologists call a phase 2-3 trial. I wonder how this is a phase 3 trial, but because this was not randomized. In any case, this is a study that looked at an IL-15 agonist called N-803 in combination with BCG in BCG unresponsive non-muscle invasive bladder cancer. So this drug, essentially N-803, is an IL-15 super agonist. So essentially it activates the innate memory and very NK cell targeting therapy. There was phase 1 data looking very promising. So 9 out of 9 patients had a clinical CR in an early phase 1 study of 9 patients. So this led to this larger study. So this is a study that was done in two cohorts. Basically, the cohort A, carcinoma in situ, similar to the group in which pembrolizumab, IV pembrolizumab is approved in a BCG unresponsive disease for CIS. So it's a similar BCG unresponsive CIS cohort. And cohort B is a papillary disease cohort that is also BCG unresponsive, but did not have CIS. So the primary endpoint in the CIS group was CR at 3 or 6 months, whereas in the second papillary cohort, the non-CIS cohort, it was disease-free survival at 12 months. So as you can see, this is not a randomized study. 88 patients in the CIS group, 77 in the papillary non-CIS group. They were heavily pre-exposed to BCG in the past. So looks like a slide is missing for some reason. But so the CR rate was 71%. And if you see the CR rate at 12 months and 24 months, you see that the duration of CR was good. So the median duration of CR was 2 years. And the CR rate was 71%. There was efficacy across all groups in this CIS cohort. And the disease-free survival rate is really good because the median DFS is very long. Now, this is the papillary group. And similarly, in the papillary group, you see a similar high good outcomes with the disease-free survival rate at 12 months of 57%, which is clearly more than the 20% bar for the lower boundary of the 95% CI that these trials have targeted. So both in the CIS group and in the papillary group, there is impressive outcomes. So durability of 24-month disease-free survival in the papillary group. Efficacy was seen across all the groups, regardless of age and gender and other characteristics of the tumor. The toxicity rates were quite tolerable. This is an intravesical therapy. This is not systemic therapy. One of the things that a lot of the urologists I spoke to were surprised by is this very low grade 3 event rate. Usually they would expect more dysuria, grade 3, and hematuria, not so low, like under 1%. That was a little surprising to some of the urologists. But overall, the high CR rate, 71% CR rate in the carcinoma in situ group, and the long duration of response with a median duration of response of 2 years was very impressive in the CIS group and also in the non-CIS group. So the investigators made a case that given the high CR rate in the CIS group with a very durable duration of response, and if you look at just the overall denominator of patients, around a third of patients maintained CR at 18 months, which is clearly higher than what we have seen looking across different studies. Looking at the pembrolizumab study, for instance, this was not this high. So as you know, with pembrolizumab, there was around a 20% durable CR rate that maintained CR continuously up to 1 year. So 20 to 25%. So it was in the low 20% range. And in the papillary disease group, again, they saw a good response, good disease-free survival rate. So the investigators argued that this is an active drug, and based on this data in this non-randomized study in a stringent population, perhaps this drug needs to be made available. And I think that the company will go to the FDA probably with these data. So coming to the third study, this is a phase 1b study that looked at trastuzumab deruxtecan combined with nivolumab in patients with HER2-expressing urothelial carcinoma. And this is in post-platinum patients with HER2 high, 2+, 3+ by IHC. And they also had a cohort 4 of HER2 low patients, but the cohort 4 did not accrue well, so only 4 patients. So really, we're going to focus on this HER2 2+ and 3+ patients who received the trastuzumab deruxtecan combined with nivolumab in post-platinum patients with progressive disease. So it's a fairly typical patient population. So the efficacy was seen. So 36.7% of patients had response in this high 2+, 3+ group. especially in the HER2 3 plus group, the responses were even more frequent, 5 out of 8 patients. So that's crossing 60% response rate in this high IHC expressing group. In the low IHC group, there were only 4 patients, but out of those 4 patients, 2 had a PR. So that's interesting because in this group, in the low IHC group, we don't expect HER2 targeting to have a lot of activity, but this might be a drug that does have activity even in low HER2 patients because of the release of the toxin in the microenvironment because of the lysable linker. Of course, this is a study done in combination with nivolumab, so you really cannot make any conclusions on this small low HER2 group. So lots of tumor regressions were seen. And toxicities were tolerable as expected. There was some interstitial lung disease seen. This has been seen with trastuzumab deruxtecan, but this was manageable and consistent with what's been reported before. There was one patient with LV dysfunction. Again, targeting HER2 can cause LV dysfunction, as we all know, but seemed very tolerable, very infrequent for this toxicity. So there was some exploratory analysis which suggested that PD-L1 CPS more than one or more might increase the enriched patients for responding to this combination. And also maybe in the blood-based high TMB group, there might be a increased chances of response. So this trastuzumab deruxtecan clearly is a drug that needs further evaluation, and study goes on in other cohorts, and we need to wait and see where this goes from here in terms of further development in a larger study, perhaps a randomized study. We're going to the next study. This is the Bayou study. There were a couple of studies that looked at PARP inhibitors in metastatic urothelial carcinoma. So this one, the Bayou study, looked at first line durvalumab alone or combined with olaparib in all comers. So we all know that there are patients with DNA damage repair alterations in the tumor. Sometimes you can have germline alterations in these patients, which we have shown. So the Bayou study design is quite simply in the first line setting, platinum ineligible or cisplatin ineligible, randomized to durva placebo or durva olaparib. And this was an all-comer study. They did not select patients for these DNA damage repair alterations. PFS was the endpoint, around 75 patients per arm. So around 20% of patients had HRR, homologous recombination repair defect alterations, which is what is expected. And these were the alterations, and these were identified based on the foundation assay. So coming to the PFS in the intention to treat group, that's the overall group, there was not a statistical difference. When you look at all comers, around a 4-month median PFS. However, when you look at the homologous recombination repair altered group, which was a small subgroup, if you notice here, less than 20 patients per arm, there was a significant difference in median PFS going from 1.8 months to 5.6 months. And this was statistically significant. When you look at overall survival in the intention to treat overall group, again, no difference. But when you look at it by the HRR alterations, again, there are trends. This study is not big enough to be powered for survival, which was a secondary endpoint, but you see some trends here. And one of the interesting findings was that in patients with the HRR alteration, they might have bad outcomes. It might be a poor prognostic factor because these patients getting durvalumab alone, you see here, had the lowest survival among all of these groups. There was anti-tumor activity, as you can expect with the durvalumab, but you see the highest response rate, 35%, is in the group that received durvalumab plus olaparib in the HRR altered group. And if you notice here, durvalumab alone with the placebo, of course, no one responded when they had the HRR alteration. So this is interesting data, suggests that this combination could have some scope in the HRR altered selected group. The safety profile was consistent with what is expected with olaparib and durvalumab. I did not see anything unexpected here. Some GI effect from the durvalumab, from the olaparib, and some of the durvalumab adverse events, some fatigue, so nothing unusual. So this combination looks interesting. So durvalumab plus olaparib might warrant further evaluation in patients with somatic or germline HRR alterations. A second study that looked at a PARP inhibitor, this was in the switch maintenance setting following platinum-based chemotherapy, is the Atlantis study that looked at rucaparib. This is a study in which patients were stable or responding post-platinum, so somewhat the javelin situation. Patients are assigned to a group based on a biomarker. And so there's a DRD group, there's an AR biomarker group, there is other no biomarker positive group. So in the DRD biomarker positive group, patients receive rucaparib or placebo. So actually there is randomization within each of these groups that the patients are assigned to. So this is the rucaparib group compared with placebo in patients who had these DNA repair defects. It's a small study, only 20 patients per arm, and the primary endpoint is PFS. So the interesting finding was that PFS did appear to show some difference. I say appear because the p-value actually did not meet significance, was 0.07, but the trends are clearly quite encouraging for improvement in PFS with rucaparib compared to placebo in the switch maintenance setting if the patient had a DNA damage repair defect in the tumor. Overall survival, again, the study is not powered for survival, but there was really not a difference found here. No unusual safety issues. Rucaparib is overall a tolerable PARP inhibitor with the routine toxicity seen with some GI and some nausea, some fatigue. So to conclude, the investigators believed and agree that there is some scope for looking at a PARP inhibitor, in this case, rucaparib, in the switch maintenance setting following platinum-based chemotherapy with stable or responding disease if the patients have a genomic alteration in a DNA damage repair defect, repair gene. And one of the things I'll point out is that the switch maintenance setting might be actually more conducive to this design, because when you're waiting for genomic testing in the first line setting, it would be hard to wait many weeks for the results to come back. While in the switch maintenance setting, you probably have had time to do these assays, send your tumor out for genomic profiling while you're giving the platinum. So this actually might be a better space to develop a genomically guided treatment. Next, I'm going to the TROPHY-U01 trial, which is a trial that looked at patients who were in this cohort, which I will focus on. There are many cohorts in the study, but in this cohort, patients received sacituzumab plus pembrolizumab if they were progressing on platinum-based chemotherapy. This is, of course, instigated by previous data looking at promising, which showed promising data for combination enfortumab plus pembrolizumab in the first-line setting, 73% response rate, and also topoisomerase 1 inhibition does have some immunogenicity as shown in preclinical models. And of course, as you know, sacituzumab is approved in the post-platinum and PD-1 setting. So in this study, how good was sacituzumab combined with pembro? 34% response rate in just over 40 patients. So there were some patients with durable responses. One of the things that the investigators did want to point out, and I don't have the slide here, is that a lot of the patients in this study had progressed on platinum and had not responded to prior platinum. Only 10% of patients who received prior platinum had responded. So there might be some selection issues that led to this somewhat low response rate when you compare across studies with the EV pembro study. Toxicities were what you would expect with sacituzumab plus pembrolizumab, nothing unusual here with the GI toxicities and some myelosuppression. So this data needs to be looked at in context because there are other trials going on. EV Pembro has graduated to the first line space where a phase 3 study is going on. So does this data make you want to look at sacituzumab Pembro in the first line? Probably not yet because of the somewhat disappointing response rate, in my opinion, in this study. And also because we are waiting for results from this EV Pembro first line study. So sacituzumab is being looked at in other trials in combination with other drugs, other immune checkpoint inhibitors. We have one we're going to open here, in fact, with the ipi-nivo plus sacituzumab IIT that we have with Moffitt. And there is also a study we have here combining sacituzumab with enfortumab that we have here, the DAD trial, which Brad and I are leading. So we're very excited about that combination. So to finish my concluding statements on this SASI plus Pembro study, I think the response rate was lower than expected. You can spin it any way you want and say that this is a small study, but I think 34% is not a lot higher than what we've seen with sacituzumab in the third line post-platinum and PD-1 setting. So maybe this drug does not play as well with immune checkpoint inhibition because of myelosuppression or immunosuppression. And maybe there is a better optimal partner, but at the end of the day, maybe we need a better biomarker and maybe we just need more data. Perhaps maybe there were some patient selection issues in this trial. The last study is the neoadjuvant enfortumab study in muscle invasive bladder cancer, cisplatin ineligible patients. This is cohort H of the EV-103 study, only 22 patients. So one thing I wanted to highlight, which I had the opportunity to discuss at GU ASCO, was that there were a ton of clinical T2N0 patients, two-thirds of patients T2N0. And there were also a ton of patients who were cisplatin ineligible just because of hearing loss, more than 40%, which is a little unusual. But this is, of course, a small study. Now, the proportion of patients with clinical T2N0 can make an impact on PathCR because we know that clinical T2N0 disease does lead to a higher PathCR rate, whether you give MVAC or atezolizumab. In different studies, when you look at it, clinical stage at baseline does matter. So you can stack your trial full of clinical T2 patients and achieve a high PathCR. So that's something to look at when you assess non-randomized phase 2 neoadjuvant studies. So the PathCR rate was 36.4%, which is, of course, quite decent in a small study with enfortumab alone, no immune checkpoint inhibitor. Toxicities were consistent with what's been seen with enfortumab. I don't have the slide here, but some urologists pointed out that there were 3 post-operative deaths out of 22 patients. But I think that this is a small study and unlikely that the enfortumab had something to do with that. Especially because the EV Pembro study, the phase 3 study is already ongoing, and nobody has stopped it early because of some excessive toxicity. So these are the phase 3 trials going on, looking at various neoadjuvant regimens. And the exciting one is the EV plus pembrolizumab. And there are also other chemo plus IO combinations in the cisplatin eligible space. So overall, EV activity does have activity in the neoadjuvant space. The PathCR rate is impressive, but does the PathCR translate to long-term improved outcomes like disease-free survival and overall survival? So we need to wait for that. And also, when we look at neoadjuvant phase 2 trials, we should always look at how many patients had the clinical T2 or T3, T4 disease, because that can clearly impact the PathCR rate. And I think we might want to also look at biomarkers to select patients in the neoadjuvant setting. As you know, we've not selected patients based on any biomarker when developing EV or SASE, but in the neoadjuvant space, when we're trying to cure more patients, maybe we want more depth of response, improved cure rates, not just improving survival a little bit. So this is something to also look at in future. Thank you.
Thanks, Guru. Fantastic presentation. And just kind of a tour de force in 25 minutes of all the updates and bladder from ASCO GU. I'll ask one quick question before moving on. what are there any trials or what one or two trials that may sort of read out or we may get some results from in the next year? Are you thinking have the most potential to change how we think about treating bladder or advanced bladder cancer?
So one of the phase 3 trials I showed you in the first line setting, Checkmate 901, I did not have time to go over it, is comparing ipilimumab, nivolumab versus gemcitabine platinum, with the co-primary endpoints of looking at improved outcomes in cisplatin ineligible and also in the PD-L1 high, regardless of what platinum patients were qualified for. So that would be one, Checkmate 901. The EV-302 trial, EV Pembro versus Gem Platinum, could come out. I'm not sure. We had to look out for that. But more importantly, maybe we will get something from the phase 2 study, the EV-103 study, which is looking at the EV versus EV Pembro in the first line cisplatin ineligible, which if holds up, you know, validates the response seen in the other EV Pembro phase 2 study with the 73% response rate. If that holds up, potentially EV Pembro could be approved, but we need to wait and see what happens with that.
Great. Thanks so much, Guru.